like to welcome you to the service this morning. We're glad you're here. Hope it'll be a blessing. So much choir. I think my left lung just kicked in, right? And I'm not sure that you could hear it before, but I'm Doyle Robertson. My wife Donna's at the keyboard, and it is just great to be here. We're excited about the week and what God is going to do for us. Please take your songbooks. Turn to number 512. 512. We're going to sing together My Savior's Love. Number 512 in your songbooks. My Savior's Love. Let's stand as we sing. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Sing it right out.
I stand amazed in the presence of
excited about God's love, shouldn't we? That chorus says, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love to me. And if you think about it, you know, it's kind of hard to sing that and think about it and sing it like this. How marvelous, you know. And so try to think about what you're singing and sing it out. You know, the Bible says, sing aloud to God. You say, Brother Doyle, somebody in front of me might hear me. That's okay, you know. They should. They should hear you lifting your voice and praising the Lord. How marvelous, how wonderful. Let's sing on that second stanza. For me it was in the garden, it says, he prayed, not my will, but thine. What a Savior we have. Let's sing it together on the second. Lift it up together, everyone.
For me it was in the garden.
Just increased about twice almost there. Now, did anybody hear somebody behind them and it bothered you? See? It's great. You can sing out and you're fine. All right. On that third stanza, I tell you what, let's do the fourth. He took my sins and my sorrows. On the fourth together.
He took my sins and my sorrows.
And wonderful to be right here, right now, looking forward to what the Lord is going to continue to do. I'll tell you, how many said that the Lord already spoke to them in Sunday school this morning. Amen? What a great meeting this morning in Sunday school. And I know the Lord has a lot more in store for each and every one of us. Amen? I'm going to open us up in prayer, and we're just going to continue with this service. Father, we do thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to gather together. We thank you for the privilege of being in your house today. Lord, we're already coming with high expectation, recognizing that, Holy Spirit of God, you're already doing great work in our hearts. We want to be absolutely open to you today, Lord. We want to be receptive to what you have for us. Use this preacher. Use all ministry today, music ministry, and everything that you're doing right now to just have your way with each and every one of us. Lord, we understand and we know, we appreciate that revival begins with me. And so, Lord, speak to me. Let's be personal about this. Let's ask you to do something in each of us individually, Lord. And Lord, we'll just give you praise and glory for what we already see you doing and what we know you're going to continue to do. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Amen. Let's all be seated. And again, it is a real joy and a privilege to have you with us. We also are thankful for anybody who might be visiting for the first time. I wonder, do we have any introductions? Any introductions? Anybody right over here? Yes, sir. Amen, amen. And you got to get around and say hello to this gentleman. He is a blessing and an encouragement to this pastor already this morning. And we're thankful for your family. We've gotten to know them over the last couple of weeks. I know your kids were here during the youth conference. And just real thrilled to have you guys with us. Anybody else? Any other introductions? Anybody? Well, that's a bunch of people back there. Anybody else? Well, if you are new with us, please, would you do this? There's a little card there in the offering plate. If it's not, our men are going to make sure that you get a card and you fill that out. Just drop it in the offering plate when it comes by. You are our honored guest, and we're happy to have you for sure. And we would love to have a record of your visit. We also have a special gift for you. And so if you're visiting with us for the first time, do we have any first-time visitors that we haven't had a chance to acknowledge yet? Well, we got a lot of folks right over here. Yes. Carly, you're supposed to be introducing your guest. So Daniel's going to do it for you, right? Is that the way that's going to work? Okay. Amen. Amen. And she's 10 years old because I got to hear everything she had to say because she was, when I drove the bus this morning, she was sitting right beside me, right behind me. Amen. Not beside me, behind me. Amen. But so good to have you, young lady. Big smile on her face. She's a real blessing. Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, listen, guys, make sure you're looking around. If we have anybody visiting with us, make sure they get a special packet. In the back. Well, you know I can't see that far back, but thank you for reminding me. Yes.
Right over here on the aisle.
On the aisle. Right over here. Yes, sir. Yes, we got a chance to say hello in the parking lot. Would you introduce your family for us, sir? Amen. We're going to get along just fine because I only speak 40% English, okay? So everything's going to work out real well. But what a blessing it is to have you. If you need any hearing assist, we do have those available at least for the preaching portion of the service. That's we have the headsets for Spanish. Did you know you were preaching in Spanish? Some people say I do a better job in Spanish, actually. Well, listen, we're happy to have each and every one of you. Again, make sure that these families get a special gift from us. We're thankful for them being here. Amen. And, you know, we're not going to go into a whole lot of detail about announcements other than this really important announcement that's been added: Ladies Bible Study, because we're all about getting into the Bible around here. Ladies Bible Study starts this Friday at 6:30 p.m. Contact Jenny Miller for more information. And so everybody knows Jenny Miller. She happens to be, she has a great father-in-law. I know that, as a matter of fact. Amen. So I want to encourage you to be a part of this class. It'll be a real blessing to you. That's for sure. Amen. All right, let's continue.
Ask me why I'm happy, so I'll just tell you why. Because my sins are gone. And when I meet the scoffers who ask me where they are, I say, my sins are gone. They're underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. In the sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. When Satan comes to tempt me and tries to make me doubt, I say, my sins are gone. You got me into trouble, but Jesus got me out. I know my sins are gone. They're underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. In the sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. I'm living now for Jesus. I'm happy night and day because my sins are gone. My soul is filled with music. With all my heart I say, I'm glad my sins are gone. They're underneath the blood on the cross of Calvary, as far removed as darkness is from dawn. In the sea of God's forgetfulness, that's good enough for me. Praise God, my sins are gone. Praise God, my sins are gone. Praise God, my sins are gone.
Amen.
Just think what he can do after a night's sleep, you know. And some of you know he had a long trip and a little bit difficult trip and pulled into the parking lot this morning at about 9:45. So just wait till he's awake and see what he can do. He'll be a real blessing. Now, he's young. He can still do that. I remember when I could drive all night and then just, you know, be ready to go. But I'm not sure I can do that anymore, you know. But anyhow, appreciate that. Praise God, my sins are gone. Well, the choir's going to sing for us, and the choir looks great, don't they? We added more chairs and almost filled up all the ones we added. So that, we added a half dozen chairs last night, and we still almost filled it up. But this evening, we're going to meet at 5 o'clock for the Revival Choir, and you come be a part of that, all right? Don't have to be a part of the regular choir. Just if you'd like to sing in the Revival Choir this week, we'd love to have you there. 5 o'clock tonight, and then the rest of the meetings will just meet a half hour early each evening. So appreciate the choir. Some of them were able to practice last night. Some just kind of jumped in here this morning, and so they feel like a little bit behind. I told them that's because they are, but it doesn't matter. They'll catch up real soon. And so I know it'll be a blessing as they sing for us, "Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It."
Thank you.
choir. You don't have to applaud. We'll be here all morning, all right? But or all day. We're going to be here all morning, right? But appreciate that. Again, if you'd like to be a part of the Revival Choir, come on 5 o'clock this afternoon right here in the auditorium. Number 295 is a great revival song, Revive Us Again, 295. We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love. 295, you have it there? Let's stand together as we sing. We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love. Sing it right out together, everyone.
We praise thee, O God.
On the third,
all glory and praise.
Tell you what, hold your places there. We're going to sing some more in a little bit. I don't know if you sometimes do this or never do it or always do it or what, but we're going to have a little time of fellowship. Just shake some hands and give some folks some smiles. Some of you look like you could use a smile, all right? So smile and get one in return, but hang on to those places. We're going to sing that last stanza in just a moment, but enjoy a time of fellowship as the instruments play. As you find your places, let's remain standing. We'll sing that last stanza. If you lost it, our choir members, you need it, 295, 295. We'll sing the last stanza, Revive Us Again, fill each heart with thy love. And maybe that be our desire and our prayer today. Revive us, fill each heart with thy love. Got it there, 295, sing it right out together on that last stanza, everyone.
Revive us again, fill each heart with thy love.
All right, let's have our men come forward. Brother Benny, would you look to the Lord for us, sir?
All right, let's pray. Oh, most gracious and heavenly Father, we gather in your house this morning, dear Lord. Thank you for the many blessings you bestowed upon us, dear Lord. Thank you for this day, dear Lord. Lord, we'd love, now that we hear this morning, dear Lord, we pray that you be with Pastor Smith, as he brings your message to us, dear Lord. Open our hearts, dear Lord, as he brings your message to us this morning. Now we pick up this offering, Lord. We pray that multiplies and be used for your ministry, Lord. We pray all this in your son's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Last week, Brother Fisher mentioned that he was pretty excited about Brother Dwight coming down. They have been working on trying to actually run into each other. Isn't it funny how these people run around in their own little circle? They just on one side of the planet and the other side of the planet, and then they finally get together here. And I love what Brother Fisher said. He feels like that you're one of the finest gospelers that we have right now, preaching the gospel with passion and spirit, and God has been using you and your family in just a wonderful way. We're so happy to have you back with us. You know, it's been now a few years that we've been friends, and before our first meeting here at Maranatha, we were able to join with sister churches in the past, and so just a thrill to have you back with us, and of course, such a thrill to have Brother Doyle and his wife back with us. How many have just said, thank you, Lord, for just a blessing this morning already? Amen? Amen. I'll tell you what you need to do. We're going to have special, and then Dwight's going to come up, but you need to already make up your mind that if somehow, some way, your schedule has gotten away with you and you're not already prepared to be here tonight, Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, I'm going to tell you what you need to do. The Lord already just told me this. Are you ready? You need to change your schedule. That's what you need to do. You need to be here, and you need to make sure that, I like what Brother Dwight said in Sunday school. You need to make sure that you bring somebody with you, and if it takes talking, inviting 30 people out to get 3 people out, then that's a good plan. That's the way we go soul winning, isn't it? That's what we do. The more people telling more people about Jesus is a pretty good plan. And more people telling more people about the meetings here at Maranatha is a very good plan. So we want to encourage you to do that. Just expect the Lord to give you something special this week. Would you do that? Would you be praying for sure? All right. And I also want to make sure, men, make sure you're ready to go at the end of the service for a love offering, and we're just thankful for what the Lord's going to do. Amen?
You know, many songs that have been a blessing to our hearts through the years were written in times of even despair or times of tragedy, times of trial and heartache. And this song that I'm going to sing this morning, a familiar song, is no different. During one of the trials of a man's life one time, Charles Weigel, he sat down and penned the words to this song, "No one ever cared for me like Jesus." I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. All my life was full of sin when Jesus found me. All my heart was full of misery and woe. Jesus placed his strong and loving arms around me, and he led me in the way I ought to go. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Yes, he cares for you.
Thank you so very much. Take your Bible, if you would, and turn with me to the book of Luke chapter 2, would you, Luke? Luke chapter 1 in the Word of God. Luke chapter 1 in the Scripture. Right, all the children can be dismissed for Children's Bible Club. All the children can be dismissed. Okay. All the children, just follow these folks right over here to your left. I'm so glad you're here. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord this morning and to be able to hear these songs and to sing and to worship with each other? Thank you for the good congregational singing. You know, you can tell a lot about a congregation by listening to them sing for just about 5 or 10 minutes. And most of the time I'm up on the platform, and I came in a little bit just right on time today, and I said, I want to stand back here a little bit and just hear everybody sing. I like to hear different perspectives and different vantage points and to see the people's enthusiasm. And thank you very much for the good enthusiasm that's here in this place today. Let's bow to ask the Lord and his blessing on our service. Father, I thank you for the privilege that's mine to once again stand in this pulpit and to preach. And I thank you for each one that's gathered here. Now, Lord, you know every heart, and you know every heart need. And dear Lord Jesus, I pray that you'd meet every single heart need this morning. I pray that you'd move us away from ourselves and from all that we have on our busy schedules. And for the next few moments, I pray that our hearts would be quiet and in tune with you and your word. Lord Jesus, I pray that you'd rebuke sin where it's needed, that you'd challenge and encourage us where it's needed. And Lord, we'll be careful to praise you and thank you for all that you do, because we ask this in Jesus' precious and wonderful name. Amen. The word Baptist is our namesake here at Maranatha Baptist Church. And I think most everybody here would be first, that is a part of this church, would be first and foremost ready to identify themselves as a believer in Jesus Christ, someone that is trying to be in the best way possible, a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the word Baptist is another name that we would unashamedly claim. And I'm glad to be a Baptist. I hope that if you're saved here and a member of Maranatha Baptist Church, you're glad to be a Baptist. I would expect, if I went to the local Lutheran church, I would expect the preacher to get up and be proud to be a Lutheran and tell me why he is that. If I went to the local Methodist church, I would expect to go and hear the preacher or the bishop give a sermon on why he's a Methodist and tell me why and give me good argumentation for why he's come to that conclusion. And I would expect him to be proud of it. And I think in a right way, it's good for those of us that are a part of this body and those that are a part of Bible-believing Baptist folk would be proud of, in a right way, of being a Baptist. You ought to be. Somebody said, well, Brother Smith, what would you be if you weren't a Baptist? I say, I'd be ashamed. That's what I'd be. And I don't think that we're Baptist because we couldn't think of anything else to put on the sign. At least I hope not. And I'd like us to look at one in the Bible who was a Baptist, John the Baptist. In fact, he was the one the Lord Jesus wanted to baptize him and went to baptize him. Now, the word Baptist means immersion, or it means to immerse or to dip or to submerge. It doesn't mean what so many of the world have come to believe. It means they think it means to sprinkle. It doesn't mean to sprinkle. The word Baptist doesn't mean to squirt with a squirt gun. It means to put all the way under. And that's what John was doing. Jesus, the Bible says, went down to John in the river of Jordan. He didn't walk all the way down waist deep so John could put a little bit of water on his forehead. That's not the way it went. He put him all the way under. Baptist in the Bible, to baptize means to dip, to submerge. But I want to say it is what we call a transliteration. In other words, we didn't define or translate the word as its definition, we just kind of transliterated it. It sounds similar in its origin. But I'm glad we chose that, because I don't know, Maranatha Dipper Church wouldn't quite sound right. Or Maranatha Immersionist Church. That's just too long to fit on the sign. And I'm glad that we're not immersionists per se, or our namesake isn't. We'd all be the dippers. That'd be kind of hard. I'd be the little dipper. Brother Ashley be the big dipper. It'd be kind of hard to figure all that out. But I'm glad we're Baptists, and I'm glad you're here in a Baptist church. And I want to talk about a man named John the Baptist this morning who was just that. Now, he was a Bible believer, and he was a believer in the Savior, the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. And one reason why we hold to Bible-believing Baptist truths is because we believe the Bible to be our only authority. That's what the B stands for, biblical authority. In other words, we don't go to the authority of a pope or a preacher or a college or a seminary or an institution. We don't wait for someone to come out with an edict or a decree or a council. We don't do that. That's not how we come to what we believe. We go to the Bible. If it's in the Bible and it's on the authority of the Bible in context, that's what we believe, and that's why we believe it. And that's what a true Baptist is. We used to preacher, are there some Baptists that aren't really? Yes. There are some Baptists by name, but they aren't really Baptists. They've denied core Bible principles that Baptists historically have held to. Let me say this. Baptists haven't always been called Baptists. study down through history, and sometimes they've been called Donatists or Novationists or Albigenses or Waldenses. But they've held to basic Bible truths that we hold to today. A few years ago, I was able to be over in northern Italy, and I was in a little town called Torrepellice, which is northwestern Italy, just at the base of the Italian Alps, and just outside a big city called Torino. And I went there because I wanted to find where the Waldenses lived, our Italian Baptist forebearers and ancestors. And I went up into the mountains, and I was led by a guide along with my family up into the mountains to a place where they had what they called the Barba College. And they took us there, a little tiny room, smaller than some of the Sunday school rooms that are here. And in it was a great big huge stone table. And in the late 1100s is when this was built, and it's still standing. And you know, it was fully in operation from the 1190s to 1290, 1390, 1490, 1590. It was in operation for well over 300 years, and what an amazing thing. They would train young preachers to go out and preach the gospel all over Europe, and hundreds and thousands of people were won to Christ because of those, our Baptist forebearers that held to the Word of God and gave their life and spilled their blood. I went way up into the mountains further, and I came to a tall cave that would probably be at the highest point about as tall as this center beam here. It was only about as narrow as maybe half of this section right here. And it was where the Waldenses would go and hide when the Catholic government would send the soldiers up to kill the Waldenses. They would stay in there sometimes weeks, sometimes months. And they would worship. They would praise God. They would go out every once in a while just to forage for food, go back to their homes if it was safe. They gave their lives there. At that particular cave, some of the government soldiers found the Waldenses, and they put a bunch of leaves on one end and they smoked them out. And as they came out, they hacked them to pieces. My, how thankful I am for our Baptist ancestors who've given their lives to hold true to the principles of God's word. No, I'm not going to lay aside that name, and I'm not going to be ashamed of that name that we bear. Thank God for it. And thank God for John the Baptist. Now, much of what he's told us in the Bible about John the Baptist is right here in Luke chapter 1. But I want you to keep your finger here and turn back with me to Matthew chapter 11. Would you, Matthew chapter 11? I want to ask this question this morning. What do you expect your life to be like 10 years from now? Do you hope that God will some way and in some measure use you in a great manner? I would hope that you hope that. I would hope and pray that you pray that. God, use me. And use me in a great way for your glory. And use me to make an impact. I would hope that would be your prayer and your heart throb and your desire. But I will tell you, when you begin to pray that, be prepared to pay a heavy price. The devil will come gunning for you because he doesn't want another Christian consecrated to the Lord. The Lord will ask you for great sacrifices because no man or woman can be used greatly unless they're willing to sacrifice and consecrate themselves fully to the Lord. We find such a one in John the Baptist. There'll be times even when you're asked to pay this great price that you'll say, Lord, is this your plan? Is this what you intended? Is this how you wanted it and were intending for it to all work out? You say, oh no. No, 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 not me. I would never question the Lord, not me. I used to say that until the Lord put me through a test here and a greater test there. And then yet even a greater test to come. You say, oh, no, 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 I would never question and analyze or doubt the Lord. Tell that to John Bunyan, another Baptist forebearer, who refused to take a license from the state or from England to preach the gospel, and as such was thrown in jail. And when his blind daughter came to him and pled with him through the bars to just take the license so that he could come home, he said, "Honey, I can't and I won't." You see, I would never question the Lord if he were to test me. Tell that to David Brainerd, who gave his life in reaching the American Indians in the early part of colonial America. You say, "Preacher, not me." No, I would never question the Lord. Tell that to William Borden, who turned aside from an entire estate, the Borden Dairy Estate, so that he could go to Africa and preach the gospel. And when he did, he didn't even fill out his first term. You say, "Oh, preacher, not me. I would never question the Lord." Tell that to Jim Elliot and his four missionary friends who less than 100 years ago gave their lives in South American soil to reach the Aka Indians of Ecuador. In this text, there is a great man whom the Lord calls great who questioned. Notice Matthew 11. "And it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples." John the Baptist is in prison for standing against evil and against sin. "And he said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, "What went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what went ye out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah 40, Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist." Watch verse number 11. "Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." So he says, there's none greater than John the Baptist that's been born of women, but he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I believe Jesus was referencing himself, because he would become a worm and no man and die on the cross. Verse 12, "And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you will receive it, this is Elias, which was for to come. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." So here we have in Matthew chapter number 11, Jesus Christ referencing John the Baptist, who had baptized him. John the Baptist, who was in prison. John the Baptist, who had just sent his disciples and asked, "Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another?" This question came from one Jesus called great. Now, I think the word great is overused in our modern day. And sad to say, I think it's overused among some Christians and among some preachers. And it might be well to just eliminate it from our vocabulary for a while till we truly understand what God considers great. But here Jesus is speaking, and when Jesus is speaking, it's absolutely infallible. And he says, there's none greater among women but John the Baptist, born among women. Interesting. Right after he had just questioned Jesus. Now some said that he sent his disciples to question Jesus because maybe they had doubts and he wanted to settle their doubts. Others said no, he was questioning because he was in a bad way. He was about to face his own death. Either way, you could say that this is a momentary lapse in a monumental life, this John the Baptist questioning. And Jesus said as much. He said, there's none greater born among women. I want to speak to you for a few moments this morning on the subject, the high cost of greatness. The high cost of greatness. I want to challenge and inspire and stir and move and motivate everyone here that knows Jesus Christ as Savior to seek God so that he might use you in a great way. Not so that you can heap greatness and glory to yourself, but so that you can heap it upon the Lord. But as I stir you and spur you and motivate you to this, I want you to understand there's a high cost of greatness. Let's discover it. Matthew chapter 11. Here the Bible says in verse 11 that notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. You know what I believe? I believe John the Baptist was great because he had adopted seven words as his life's motto. He must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease. In fact, the greater you are used of God, the less you become, and the greater He becomes. The less you are used of God, it's because He has become less and you have become more. Notice our text, Matthew 11, verse number 11. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Watch this. If you will embrace the high cost of greatness, be willing to pay the high cost of greatness, be willing to go down low to where God can use you, mark it, it will dramatically influence every area of your life. It'll impact your ministry, your relationships. It'll impact your standing in the community. It'll impact how you're used of God and how you see God and how you see yourself. It'll forever change how you look at this matter of being used of God. Being used of God is a great privilege and a great joy, but there's a great price that must be paid. Notice he paid this price in just a few areas. Number one, John the Baptist paid this price in his mandate. His mandate. You said, preacher, what do you mean? All right, we're here in Luke chapter 1. Let's just see. He was mandated or divinely selected to do a specific task and to fulfill a specific calling. And just like John the Baptist has been given a specific task and a specific calling, so have you. So have you. Notice here in Luke chapter number 1 where we're at, I want you to notice several facts about him. Did you know that his life, John the Baptist's life, was prophesied hundreds of years before by a prophet named Isaiah? In Isaiah chapter 4, he said, comfort ye my people, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And that's exactly what John the Baptist would say later. Did you know that his birth was foretold by an angel? Look here at Luke chapter number 1 and verse number 9. Verse 8, and it came to pass that while he, that is Zacharias, John the Baptist's dad, was executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. Do you know his birth was prophesied hundreds of years earlier by one of the great prophets, Isaiah? It was foretold by an angel. Did you know that he was specifically an answer to prayer? Notice again verse 13. He said, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. Zacharias and Elizabeth were one of those older couples in the Bible, and they'd been praying, God, give us a son. God, give us a son. God, give us a son. And even though they didn't have any children, they never let go of praying that. Even though they were past the flower of their age, even though they were past their fruit-bearing years, they never let go of praying that. They said, Lord, give us a son. Do you know he was miraculously born to old parents? Look at verse number 18. As the angel and Zechariah are talking, Zechariah said unto the angel, whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man and my wife well stricken in years. Now, he probably was just telling the truth. I know he was. But I wouldn't advise any man referring to your wife as well stricken in years. No. That wouldn't be a good marital relationship moment. He said, my wife is well stricken in years. Now, how am I going to know this? And because of that unbelief, God smote Zacharias with silence for the next 9 months. Verse number 19, and the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel that stand in the presence of God and am sent to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings. So here he was born of old parents. In verse 58, her neighbors and her cousins heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her and they rejoiced with her. She was a woman well stricken in years. Did you know that he's the only recorded individual who was filled with the Holy Ghost in the womb and who leaped in the presence of the Messiah? Now, watch this. This was John the Baptist. So John the Baptist was in the transitional stage between the Testaments, Old and New. And so in the Old Testament, there wasn't the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit. There was the ondwelling. He came upon his saints. In the New Testament, he does not just dwell on us, though we need his ondwelling for service. He dwells in us. That's the indwelling. John the Baptist is in the transition between the Testaments. And there, at the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, while his mother, Elizabeth, is standing in front of Mary, who is pregnant with child, with the Son of God, the Son of the Highest, he leaps in the womb, the only one. Notice, do you notice about him and about him that with all of these things true, his name did not fit the usual mold? Look at verse 59. They wanted to name him when he was first born, and it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, not so, but he shall be called John. And they said unto her, there is none of thy kindred that is called by this name. And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table and wrote, saying, his name is John. And they marveled all. You see, his name did not fit the usual mold. Did you know that his birth was surrounded by the hand of God and God's mysterious workings? Look at verse number 64. And his mouth was open, Zacharias' mouth, when he wrote down the name of John. His mouth was opened, and his immediately, and his tongue loosed, and he spake and praised God. And fear came on all that dwelt round about them. And all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea. Wow. Did you know that God had a specific task for him to perform and to fulfill? Listen to Zacharias as after 9 months, he verbalizes his praise to God. Verse number 67, and his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Now watch. This might not mean something to somebody sitting here in 2017 in this modern age and day. This might not mean anything to those of us who praise God on a regular basis. But where is Luke and where are the Gospels? After the 400 silent years. So for a child to be born of old parents, to not take his father's name, to have all of these mysteries and strange divine happenings around him, and for his father to have been silenced for 9 months and now to speak, it got everybody's attention. He hath raised up an horn of salvation, verse 69, for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the Highest. For thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Watch me. From his birth and before his birth, God Almighty had put a unique and specific mandate and calling upon him. And watch me, John the Baptist didn't reject it. You know, it takes humility to seek God's will for your life and embrace that and reject your own. Can I say it this way? It takes humility and a he must increase and I must decrease attitude to say, God, not my will, but thine be done. It takes humility to say, God, I'm not concerned about my desires and my wants and what my ambition is. I want what your will is for my life. Let me say to you, young person, God has a specific calling and a specific plan for your life. And the best thing you could do, and the only way you'll find success, is if you find it and do it. God has that same calling and mandate for every adult in this place. No matter what your age and no matter what your past choices or attitude towards God's will for your life, from this moment forward, you can have a not my will, but thine be done attitude and embrace God's will for your life. Number one, we notice that John the Baptist began to pay the high cost of greatness because of his mandate and his embrace of God's mandate in his life. You see, I want to say you're significant in the sight of Almighty God. Not insignificant, not unimportant. There is no such thing as an insignificant soul, and there's no such thing as the unspecific will of God. Everyone here is significant. If we were to take a Google Earth image and we were to zoom down on the North American continent and a little further down onto America and then down to the great state of Texas and then down even further to the southern tip of Texas and to the Harlingen and McAllen area, and we were to zoom down past the roof here of Maranatha Baptist Church and zoom down on your life, there would be a glowing neon spot on your life saying that God deems you very significant to His task and to His cause. Oh, I challenge you to find God's will and do it. And if you're in the midst of doing God's will, do it. If you're teaching a Sunday school class, it's not insignificant. It's vitally important to His cause. If you have a responsibility as a deacon, it's not insignificant. It's vitally important. If you're singing in the choir, your voice is not insignificant. And when silenced, it surely will be missed. When it's absent, it surely will be felt. I want to tell you, you're a very significant soul in the eyes of Almighty God. He has a specific will, find it and do it. Number two, his marks. We know that he paid the high cost of greatness because of God's mandate for him that he embraced, but number two, because of his marks. You said, preacher, what do you mean? All right, take your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 3, would you? Matthew chapter 3, and let's get an even greater understanding of this one named John the Baptist. An even greater understanding. Let me just pause and say, somewhere in John's life, he made the choice to be born again, to be saved. That means he put his faith in the Lord as the only one that could set him free from his sin. John the Baptist wasn't perfect. No person in the Bible was perfect except the Lord Jesus Christ. John the Baptist needed salvation, and somewhere in his early life, he made the choice to put his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and as such, he was marked. He had a different conversion. He had a different conduct. He had a different conviction. He had different clothes. He had a different character, and he embraced that as his marks. Matthew chapter 3, notice verse 1, in those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins. And his meat was locusts and wild honey. I like what one preacher friend of mine recently said. He said, you know, preachers usually are marked when they go out in the community. You can see. You say, oh, that's a preacher. The way he dresses, the way he carries himself. Preachers kind of dress a certain way, and they kind of carry themselves in a certain way. And there's a reason for that. Preachers, they want to be distinct, and they don't want to just blend in. And so sometimes when you see a preacher, they stand out. And preachers eat. They eat a little different than the average person. They love fried chicken. Can I get an amen right there? They say, you know what a preacher's belt is? It's a picket fence around a chicken graveyard. I want you to know, there's been more foul meat that's gone in the ministry than any other kind. I want you to know. Preachers eat a little different. But you know, here is a preacher that isn't dressed like the average preacher, and he doesn't eat what the average preacher eats. And sometimes there's what we call preacher pressure. Preachers get around each other, and they find out how many they had at church last Sunday, and they find out what's going on in each other's ministry. And sometimes it's all well-meaning and good, and sometimes it's to put a little pressure on each other. But here was a preacher that didn't dress like the average preacher, and he didn't eat like the average preacher. And the Bible says here in Matthew chapter 3 and verse number 5, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Hear me and hear me well. You don't follow what the crowd does. You do what God says. And you let God mark you. He was marked. You know, I could be very well speaking to a young person in this room right now who's afraid to stand up for Jesus Christ and afraid to stand out for Jesus Christ because you know it will mark you. You know that when you're different, you're going to have to not blend in. You know that in your character and in your conduct and in your conviction and in your clothing, there ought to be something different. And you don't want to be different. You just want to blend in with the crowd. I'm going to tell you, you better get rid of that fear of man in a quick hurry. Because that takes a certain measure of humility and a willingness to pay the high cost of greatness to say, Lord, I'm willing to be marked. I'm willing to be different. I'm willing to be set aside and unique. He was marked. You said, preacher, how? Now watch, I'm not talking about weirdness. There's plenty of Baptist weirdness that goes around. Someone said, a friend of mine was preaching for a mutual friend of ours. And he said, brother, he said, every church has a few gospel bugs, but yours is infested. There's just some weirdness that sometimes goes around. You know, the gospel light can attract some strange bugs. I'm not talking about weirdness. When I was in college training for ministry, there was plenty of that to go around. You want weirdness, you go into a Baptist Bible college's dormitory. You'll find it. You'll find it. One guy washed his hair with a combination of Whisk laundry detergent and shaving cream. We kind of got him aside and said, you know, they've invented this great thing called shampoo. It really works well. Another guy, he had a Philly cheesesteak sandwich delivered to him from his mom in Philadelphia on real ice. And we all figured out then why he was the way he was. I'm sure the ice was frozen when he started out, but it was a puddle when he got to the place where he was intended. There was another guy there that was very OCD about everything on his shelves, and he had to have everything just right, and he'd have his quarters stacked and his dimes stacked and his nickels stacked just right, heads on heads on heads. Some of you are looking at each other like you know somebody in this room like that. And if you took and turned one of the coins over so it was tails, he'd come in, take one glance, and say, somebody's been messing with my stuff. You know, that's a little weird. We always found the guys that spent a lot of time on the submarine especially were weird. I don't know if that's any Navy guy here, but we just felt like that. There's plenty of weirdness to go around. One guy in college, he kind of rocked back and forth in college. He was another submariner, been in college. Look here, I'm not talking about weirdness, but I'm talking about a willingness to be different. How about it, young lady? You willing to be different than all the rest of your peers? In your disposition? In your character? In your honesty? In your integrity? In your appearance? How about it, sir? Are you willing to be different than all the rest of your peers in your work ethic? In your passionate love for God? Watch this. There's only one person to please. And one thing to prove. And I prove to that one person I'm pleasing. Nothing else matters. If you're right this way, you'll be right this way. If you're right vertically, you'll be right horizontally. So many times we live in the fear of man, and the Bible has a very clear, unequivocal statement on it. The fear of man bringeth a snare. But whoso putteth his trust in the Lord, he shall be safe. Here he was different. He was different in his sacrifice. He sacrificed popularity, normalcy, applause, acclaim, notoriety, and more. He was different in his hair. You said, preacher, how? Luke 1:15 tells us he was a Nazarite from the womb. That means he was a lifetime Nazarite. You said, preacher, what was a Nazarite? A Nazarite was somebody under a Nazarite vow. He said, wasn't Jesus a Nazarite? No, Jesus was not. He was from the town of Nazareth, which made him a Nazarene. Like you're from Texas, so we'd call you a Texan. That's what Jesus was. He was a Nazarene from the town of Nazareth. He was not a Nazarite. A Nazarite came under a spiritual vow for a month or 6 months or 10 months or 12 months. And he stayed under that Nazarite vow until he was done. And all the while, he was distinct. A Nazarite wouldn't touch grapes. They wouldn't eat grape juice or eat raisins. They wouldn't drink grape juice. They certainly wouldn't drink strong drink because that was alcohol and always forbidden in the Bible. Watch, he was a Nazarite, so he was distinct. He was set apart. He was marked by his sacrifice. He was a lifetime Nazarite, one of three in the Bible, Samson, Samuel, and John the Baptist. If John the Baptist came in, that means he would never cut his hair. If John the Baptist came in and sat down in this place, most people here would look at him like this and scoot over a little bit. He looked different. He was marked by his suffering. He was not afraid to confront the religious hierarchy of his day and the political hierarchy of his day. He was not afraid to call sin, sin. Watch, he embraced the high cost of greatness in his mandate, in his marks. Watch, he embraced the high cost of greatness in his manner. In his manner. You said, preacher, how? Look at verse 13 of our text. In verse 13 it says, then cometh Jesus from Galilee unto Jordan to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? In other words, his manner was humble. You know, on the desk of a former president, Ronald Reagan, there was a sign in the Oval Office that read, you can be too big for God to use, but you can never be too small. That's the idea of John the Baptist. His manner was that he was a humble servant. He was not a place-loving courier. He was not the light. He said, I'm not the light. I've come to bear witness of the light. He was not filled with arrogance. He was not self-promoting. He was humble in his abode, in his simple life, in his attire, in his preaching. What he was, he said, I'm a witness to that light. I'm just a porter opening the door. I'm not the bridegroom. I'm just the bridegroom's friend. I'm a servant. I'm a forerunner. I'm a humble servant. That was his manner. You know, it was Bob Jones Sr. who said, everybody wants to be the grand ballroom chandelier. What's needed is for someone to be a lone little light bulb in the black back hall room closet to keep the janitor from stubbing his toe. Nobody wants that kind of recognition. We all in our flesh want more, more, more. John the Baptist said, I want less, less, less. His manner showed that he paid the price. I want you to notice his message. Look at his message right here. Look at his message right here in verse number 2. He began to preach saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Look at verse number 5. Then went out unto him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Look at verse number 7. When he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore every tree that bringeth forth not, which bringeth not forth good fruit, is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will throughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. His message showed he was willing to embrace the high cost of greatness and pay it. His message, you said, preacher, what do you mean? Well, his message was fearless. It confronted the Pharisees in Matthew 3 and Herod in Matthew 14. It was doctrinal. You know, it's interesting to me, Pastor, to hear these modern preachers de-emphasize doctrine. And modern singing groups de-emphasize doctrine. We're not singing about doctrine. Let's just lay all our doctrine aside and hold our hands and sing kumbaya and let the rainbows shine and the doves fly. Friends, that sounds good, but there's a word for it, baloney. It's not what's going to make you strong. You need doctrine. Doctrine just means teaching. And you need to be able to discern what is the right doctrine and what is the wrong doctrine. Embrace the one and reject the other. And say, I'm only going to go with Bible doctrine. His message was doctrinal. It was effective. They went to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Samaria, and the regions round about Jordan. Watch it. To name a few doctrines, he preached on the Trinity. He believed in the Holy Spirit. He preached Jesus, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. He preached on the difference between a saved man and a lost man. His message was a message of surety, of purity, of judgment, and of hell. Y'all, tell you, it takes someone humble, willing to pay the high cost of greatness, to preach a message like that. Watch, we know that he embraced it in his mandate, in his marks, in his manner, in his message. But finally, I want you to notice in his motto. Look here at John chapter 3. Would you? John chapter 3, and we're through. John chapter 3, and we'll be done. Notice, please, what the Bible says. In John chapter 3, in verse 25, I love this. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, that is Jesus, to whom thou bearest witness, you said, behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. Hey, this is the man that you need to follow. He said, the same baptizeth and all men come to him. John's disciples were concerned about that. Verse 27, John answered and said, I love this. Look at verse 27. A man can receive nothing except that it be given him from heaven. Look this way for just a moment. Look this way. My friends, the sooner you and I realize this truth, the better off we'll be and everybody else around us. That a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. You say, preacher, I want influence for good and for God. You can have it, but it better be something God gives you. If you drum it up, you muster it up, you manufacture it, you put up the pretense that you have it, pretty soon it's going to make your life and everyone else around you miserable. A man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. You know what I believe? He understood what Job said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He's the giver of every good gift. I don't have it because of myself. Verse 28, ye yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. I've heard his voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled. Watch verse 30. He said, he must increase, but I must decrease. Now my friends, this is the litmus test to prove whether or not you and I have embraced the high cost of greatness. You say, preacher, I want to be used of God. Good. You say, preacher, I want to be used of God greatly. Good. Are you willing to pay the price? You say, what's the price? He must increase, but I must decrease. Now, I know a lot of songs in our songbook that are all about he must increase, but I don't know very many that are about I must decrease. You know what the word decrease means here? By the way, it's the only time it's used in the New Testament. It means to decrease in authority or rank or popularity. To make lower. To make inferior in dignity. To be made less or inferior. To lessen in rank or influence. John the Baptist was the one that all of Judea went to hear. And now his church is getting smaller. Jesus' church is getting bigger. John the Baptist is put in prison. He sends a message to Jesus. Are you the one that should come? Or do we look for another? And Jesus' answer, are you listening? Was enough for John. It's okay. He must increase, but I must decrease. Let me apply it. How about it in your marriage? Anytime in your marriage you embrace this motto, he must increase, but I must decrease, it'll make it sweet. Anytime in your marriage, I must increase and he must decrease, it'll make it sour. How about it as a parent or a child? How about it as a church member? How about it as a worker in the valley? Is it he must increase, but I must decrease? Or is it I must increase, he must decrease. You can't have it both ways. And you can't have the one, he must increase, without the other. You see, in my mind this morning, I can see a young teenage John who was raised in the obscurity of the Judean deserts and who had trusted Christ as his Savior. And he wondered one day how his life would unfold, and there out on the hillside, he just came to this conclusion. No matter what, he must increase, but I must decrease. I can see him as he enters adulthood and begins to sense ever more clearly God's plan for his life. I can see one of his friends come to him and say, "Hey, John, what's your take on life?" I can see John without hesitation saying, "He must increase, but I must decrease." I witness John the Baptist as he begins his public ministry, and I can see the throngs of Judea and Jordan and Samaria coming to him. I can see him as he peers out across the crowd and is about to speak, whisper a prayer to the Lord, say, "Lord, help me today. You must increase. I must decrease." I can witness as Jesus asked to baptize him. And he says, "Lord, comest thou to me? I have need to be baptized of thee. You must increase. I must decrease." I can see him as the Pharisees come and he embraced that hard and strong message of judgment. And as he does, he says, "Lord, you must increase, but I must decrease." I can see John as he tucks his Bible under his arm and stands before Herod and rebukes him for being an adulterer and swallows hard because he knows what's to follow. And all the while he says, "He must increase. I must decrease. I'll not back away from the truth." I can see him as some of his disciples begin to question the validity of Jesus. And he says, "Well, I'll tell you what." And he scribbles something down on a piece of paper. He says, "Would you take this to Jesus and bring it back to me and the answer?" And they take it to him. And Jesus stands and reads the question, "Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another?" He scribbles back a reply and sends it back. And as John takes it inside and looks at it, folds it and puts it in his pocket and says, "I thought so. He must increase, but I must decrease." I can see John the Baptist as they take him out of the cell and lead him to the chopping block and kneel him down. And the man with no face is just about to take his life. And he asks John, "John, do you have any final words?" And John the Baptist says, "Yes. As a matter of fact, I do. He must increase, but I must decrease." And I can see a throng of blood-washed saints as they gather around the throne of the nail-pierced one, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I can see one strange saint standing up to bring his crowns many-fold before the Lord Jesus. I can see him as he lays them there at his feet. And when he does, he bows and lifts his hand and says, "Jesus, you must increase, but I must decrease." Would you bow with me in prayer? I thank you for your attention to the Word of God this morning. How many of you would say, "Brother Smith, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I know it is my responsibility to embrace humility and reject pride. But lately I've found myself in some way, small or great, embracing pride and rejecting humility. And I need to ask the Lord to forgive me this morning and to change that." If that's you with heads bowed and eyes closed, would you just quietly lift your hand and let me pray with you? God bless you. Thank you. Who else? A preacher, pray for me. Pray for me. I've found myself recently embracing pride and rejecting humility. Pray that I would change that and ask God's strength and yield to his power to change that. Anybody else, slip up your hand, put it right back down. God bless you. God bless you. Question number two, how many of you without hesitation can say, Brother Smith, there are some things that I don't know, but there's one thing I do know. If I died now, I know I'd go to heaven. I've been saved. If I died 10 years from now, I know I'd go to heaven because I've been saved. I've asked the Lord Jesus to wash my sin away and to give me eternal life. If that's you, would you slip your hand up high? Preacher, I know that I'm saved and on my way to heaven. There's no doubt about it. I've been born again. Thank you. Put your hands down. I wonder if you're here this morning and you're one who couldn't raise your hand. You said, Brother Smith, I don't know. I'm not sure where I'm going when I die, but I need to be sure. And I want to be sure. Would you pray for me? I will. I'll not embarrass you or single you out, but I'd like to pray for you and pray with you. Is there anyone here like that? Just slip up your hand. In a moment, I'll remember you in prayer. Preacher, I'm not sure that I'm saved. I don't know where I'm going when I die, but I'd like to be sure. Would you pray for me? Anyone at all, slip up your hand and put it right back down. All right, let's stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed. Everyone standing. Father, in a moment we're going to sing a few verses of Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Have Thine Own Way. And I pray in Jesus' name that that would be our prayer and our attitude and our heart's cry. Help us, Lord, like John, to embrace and to begin. Jesus, to reject pride and embrace humility and pay whatever the cost is so that you'll be magnified. We pray this in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, as the pianist gives us a chord and we begin to sing that old familiar song, Would You Come? God spoke into your heart. We're only going to have a couple stanzas. God spoken to you. Would you respond and let him have his way? Have thine own way.